Pastor Russ with Reach Ministries, which is part of New Life Lutheran Churches in Kenosha, Wisconsin. And actually, I just recently accepted the call to serve full-time at New Life, with a big portion of my time being spent on Reach Ministries. And one of the focuses, both of Reach and of New Life, is for me to be spending more time on campus, so I'm looking forward. I've gotten to see you over the last semester a few times. I'm looking forward to being on campus with you more. And it's an honor and wonderful to be able to be with you today to bring you God's Word. So today we're going to be looking at John 10, and the theme is supposed to be this. It's supposed to be seeking to bring others into the fold. John 10 is where we talk about the Good Shepherd, Jesus being that shepherd who cares for his flock, but John 10 has a lot of things, so we're certainly going to speak about bringing others into the fold, but there's a couple other worthwhile things to speak about in this chapter as well. So maybe to give you two thoughts that we're going to think about today. Number one, we're going to think about what it looks like to listen for our shepherd's voice. And then number two, we also will be thinking about what it means to be bringing other people into the fold. So to think about that first one, what does it look like to listen to the shepherd's voice? We're going to look at John chapter 10, verses 1 through 5, and then verse 10 as well. I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheep pen by the door, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. The doorkeeper opens the door for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought all of his own sheep, he walks ahead of them. The sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will never follow a stranger, but will run away from him because they do not know the voice of a stranger. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that you may have life and have it to the full. I mean, there's maybe a basic fact to get out right away. How do you get to that point where you know your shepherd's voice and you're able to listen to it and identify it? The answer, to know God's word better, right? That's where God and Jesus, that's where they speak most clearly. That's where we hear their voice without anything hindering it, right? And so to have that desire inside of us, to go back to his word and to know it better. And that's why if you have anyone in your life that has kind of drenched that desire and treated God's word as something that is dull and boring, just kind of this classwork type thing that you need to be spoon-fed, right? Fight that temptation to treat God's word that way, because it is a beautiful and powerful thing, and it helps us make sense of life. But still on that question, how do we know our shepherd's voice and hear our shepherd's voice? The easy answer was right there, right? To know God's word better. And that's an important piece of the puzzle, maybe one of the most important pieces. But the question becomes more complicated when we look at the world around us. When we look at the world around us and assess those voices in the world around us, how do we decide? How do we figure out which of those voices are coming from our Savior? Which of them line up with God's word? Or which of them just depart from God's word entirely? Or what are those voices that kind of mix God's word and some other things that are a little off base? And to talk about that one, I want to give you kind of this tool to help identify and evaluate voices out in the world. So here it is. Firstly, when you run into voices in the world and you're trying to figure out, does this voice align with my shepherd, with my Savior Jesus? A three-step process, right? Firstly, identify and evaluate the questions that those voices are asking. Identify and evaluate the questions that those voices are asking. And then number two, identify and evaluate the answers that are being given. And how do you figure out what answers are being given by the voices in the world around us? Well, you look at their actions. You look at their attitudes. And then finally, number three, after you've done that, after you've identified and evaluate the questions being asked and the answers being given, then take it back to God's word and see what he has to say. To kind of make this a little more concrete for us, let's go back to the verse and let's think about what's happening there, and then let's turn it to the world around us. So first of all, in that section, right, we had about the thief and the robber coming in the sheep pen, right, which is where we as God's children, his sheep, are. But they didn't go through the door like our good shepherd Jesus, right? Instead, they come over the fence, or they come over the side to get in. And from verse 10 there, you can see, right, their intent is to steal, to kill, and to destroy, right? Although they might look like they are good-intentioned, well-intentioned, their actions show that is different, right? And so now to think about the context of this just a little bit. If we were to reach back to John chapter 9, we get the sense that here Jesus might be speaking with kind of a mixed crowd. It doesn't give us specifics in John chapter 10 about who he's speaking with, but back in John chapter 9, it's a mixed crowd, and there's some Pharisees in that crowd. And so it's interesting, provided Jesus didn't go somewhere else, but this is all part of the same conversation, that Jesus has a mixed crowd here, and it's interesting that there are Pharisees in that crowd, and that he goes about speaking about this topic. Because you think about the Pharisees, although they looked wonderful on the outside, although they were the religious and the holy people of the day, the people that were asking the right questions. What does God want me to do? How does God want me to live? That's a good question. That's a wonderful question. And the Pharisees were asking that question. But then you get to part two of that tool I gave you, right? Identify and evaluate the answers that are being given. Look at the resulting actions and attitudes. And so you get to the Pharisees and you come to realize that they're not taking care of Christ's sheep. Because although they're asking good questions, the answers that they're coming up with were quite wrong. Rather than pointing people to the Messiah, to their Savior from sin, they were pointing people inward. They were pointing at themselves, saying, look at how good I am. Look at the good works that I do. Look at my good life. And that's what you need to do as well. That is how you earn God's favor. So in Jesus' mind and in actuality, they would have been some of those thieves and those robbers that come in to steal and to kill and destroy. And so you've evaluated the questions that are being asked, right? The Pharisees were asking, you know, how does God want me to live? And that's a great question, but you look at the answers being given. They weren't pointing people to Christ. Rather, they were pointing people to themselves. They were pointing people inward. You have to do what it takes to earn God's favor. So you take that back to God's word, and we figure out that's not right, right? While that worldly voice might be asking a good question, it seems to be missing something, and it's not lining up with my Savior's voice. Because of time today, we can't get too far into the conversation, but you can do this in the world around you. There's so many voices in today's world. Just an example that immediately came to my mind as I thought about this section and application was the conversation on justice. Because you have people on opposite ends of the spectrum for everything in our world that want to talk about justice. They want to talk about justice for minority cultures. They want to talk about justice for the underprivileged. They want to talk about justice for the unborn, for those who don't have a voice. And so I've had so many of these conversations with people, and I can always tell where people are at, and I always have that starting ground. You say, what are the questions that are being asked? And some of those questions out there are such good questions. They're questions that we need to be asking as Christians. How do I stand up for justice for my neighbor, regardless of who they are, regardless of their ethnicity, regardless of their place in life, regardless of whether they have a voice or not? But then you get to the part of evaluating what are those answers being given. And so many times when people get caught up in the worldly conversations, the answers that are being given look more like those who would hop the fence rather than come in through the shepherd's gate. You can tell that those answers come from a place of hate. Those answers come from a place of wanting to inflict harm on others who don't see eye to eye with them. And that's not how our good shepherd would have us treat them. It's important for us to think through this, because then we get to this next section. Let me read these final verses and we'll get our last thought in here for today. So looking now at John chapter 10, verses 14 through 18. I am the good shepherd, Jesus speaking. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I also have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. I must also bring them. They will listen to my voice. Then there will be one flock and one shepherd. This is why the Father loves me, because I lay down my life so that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down on my own. I have the authority to lay it down, and I have the authority to take it up again. This is the commission I received from my Father. Reaching back to what we spoke about, a tool for us to evaluate those voices in the world and seeing if they line up with our Savior's, right? You identify and evaluate the questions that are being asked. You identify and evaluate the answers that are being given. What are the resulting actions and attitudes? And you bring it back to God's Word, and you see what God's Word has to say. And why is it so important to do that? It is so important to do that because of what Jesus says right here. This was Jesus' sole focus. It was his sole mission, was to bring sheep into the sheep pen, to bring those who did not yet know about him to him, right? Jesus, remember the context here, he's probably speaking with a Jewish audience. So this would have been kind of a mind-blowing concept for them, that it wasn't just the nation of Israel that God had in mind to bring salvation, but instead it was what the Jews called the Gentiles, right? Everyone who is not of Jewish descent. And that would have been a difficult thing for them to wrestle with, because for so long they had been God's chosen nation. But that was Jesus' purpose. Regardless of race, regardless of any tension or dividing lines that we set up as human, Jesus had sheep out there in the world that he wanted brought into the fold. So my brothers and sisters in Christ, leaders of tomorrow, it is so important that we search for God's word, for his voice, and we find it in his word. And the better we come to know that, the better we are better able to assess the voices in the world around us. Because if we're not careful to take time to assess them, what ultimately happens is our focus shifts. It shifts to something worldly. And while some of those worldly causes are good and important and worthwhile, and we should partake in them to a certain extent, to help our neighbor and to show love to our neighbor and to build bridges for the sake of Christ, it is so easy to get lost and caught in them, to the point that you forget your mission, the same mission as your good shepherd. So my brothers and sisters in Christ, go back to God's word, think about it critically, look at the world around you, assess the voices critically, and do it using God's word. And as you do that, don't lose your missional mindset, that missional mindset to bring others into the fold by telling them about who Christ is. Use the conversations going on in the world to engage. And then look for those open doors that God's going to provide you to talk about your good shepherd. Amen. God's blessings to you. Let's close with a brief prayer. Gracious Father in heaven, we seem to live in a world that is more and more angry and hostile and divided. There's so many people going in so many directions, so many people fighting for so many causes. And so many of those causes come from places and people that are asking good questions, that are frustrated with the effects of sin we see in the world around us. And Lord, you tell us to be frustrated about the effects of sin too. You tell us to work for the good of our neighbor, and we're certainly to do those things. But Lord, keep us coming back to your word. Keep us humbled. Keep us reminding and constantly remembering the great lengths to which you went to save us. And Lord, as we come to better understand that, we ask that you would change our heart. That while all the conversations and topics in the world around us are important, and we should dedicate an amount of our time to helping our neighbor through these conversations, Lord, we ask that our sole focus, the focus that is above all else, would be the same one you had, to bring others into the fold, to be willing to give up what is ours, to give up what we hold dear, to give up whatever it takes, just as you did, so that we might reach people with Christ. All this we bring to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Y'all have a wonderful rest of your week, and I hope to see you soon. I'm sure I'll be around campus before too long. God's blessings.